Father, thank you for the fellowship of the saints and the privilege to worship God and to know your voice. We've received your love and we thank you so much. We've received your word and your Holy Spirit. We've received all the blessings that come from the suffering of your Son. And names are written above, we're so glad. And I ask, Lord, that today in these few moments remaining of this morning to us, that you'd multiply your grace to every heart, and that each one here would be given eyes to see goodness, the goodness of God, and the truth of Christ. I bless your people. I thank you for them. Holy Spirit, be a helper today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Friends, it's a good bit later than it normally is when we are at this point of the service. And normally we seek to finish more or less a teaching by about 10:30, which is only 15 minutes away. And so I'm going to just a little summary of what I'd prepared. I had prepared really what I think interesting, compelling message today, and we'll concern ourselves with some of that in the near future, especially when all the church is back from their mission trips. But anyway, we've taken time today over mission reports, and it's very good. I thank the Lord for the news and the fellowship. Meanwhile, lend me your ears, as Shakespeare wrote in a famous drama. Let me chat with you for a quarter of an hour or so and see if I can give you an overview of the issue that I was trying to address today. I've been reading various books this last year or two, especially because I wanted to develop real accuracy with what we know and believe about the many things that the Holy Scriptures say that people take as, you know, last things. All the kind of scriptures that get put in this category of eschatology, I wanted to understand it because I, as well as anybody, have known, and I've been a Christian now over 45 years, I've been in the ministry almost 40 years, I know as well as anybody that this subject on the whole is confusing to most Christians, has very strong voices, strident voices that argue for all kinds of alarmist positions. And yet, when you're a reader of the Bible day by day, those alarmist positions do not stack up properly with most of the Bible. And you end up having heard what was said in the few scriptures quoted and the interpretation put on those scriptures. But then you read all these other scriptures and it leaves you thinking, well, do we apply that to it or do we apply this to it? And the truth is a lot of those scriptures were misapplied. But you don't really understand that unless you understand the history, the Jewish history properly, unless you understand the early church history, and unless you understand the meaning of words and expressions as understood by the Jews 2,000 and 3,000 years ago. So if you'd had a Jewish education, not just a Jewish education as you'd get today, but the Jewish education in that culture, what would you have understood was meant by the things that were written? That's what has to be understood by us today, bearing in mind that almost the entire New Testament, except for Luke, who was the only Gentile, all the rest of the New Testament was written by Jews who had that education and who were freely using the expressions and terminology that came out of the Old Testament, but they were applying them to gospel times. And that's why we have to understand the old to interpret the new properly. At the same time, we have to take strongly and clearly everything that the new says with respect to what it tells us about the meaning of the old. So we have had in more recent times, in your lifetime and mine, in the last 100 years in particular, we have seen the spiritual demise of the nations that constitute the West. So I'm talking English culture, we're talking America and Canada and Australia and New Zealand and European culture generally. This part of the world, what we know of as the West, was for the longest period of time the really strong base of Christianity in the world. Christianity was preserved in Europe. It was rediscovered more biblically in Europe with the Reformation. The great missionary movements came out of Europe, out of England in the end in particular, but prior to that, the real father of the modern missionary movement, not William Carey, who's English, but was actually Count Zinzendorf, who was German, and who was Carey's inspiration, but it was the British who took the gospel to the world. The British system of government is the finest system of government in the world. None of them are perfect, but it's the best we have, the Westminster system. Out of that came very, very high standards of education, of hygiene, of science, of basically of every art and science known to man, engineering. It was the gospel that established and built all of these things, the emancipation of women, the fair treatment of labour. So in other words, all the early trade unions were Christian movements. In Melbourne, it was the primitive Methodists. Primitive was a technical term, but it was Christians more than anything that founded labour movements that were looking for fair treatment of workers. It was Christians who worked for the emancipation of women and getting women the vote and so on and so forth. All of these things were gospel outcomes. The trouble is that in your lifetime, these things have been polluted. The union movement has been corrupted. The Labour Party was initially, at its inception, very Christian. Lots of Christians in it. There came a point most of them left. It became corrupted. The same deal with, what had been a Christian work to emancipate the role of women in society and bring about the honor of women, very much a Bible outcome, a gospel outcome, was the improving of the lives of women all over the world. But then, in your lifetime, this was hijacked with feminism. And so then in your own lifetime, you've seen the rise of abortion, the rise of homosexuality, the rise of divorce, the sexual revolution. You've seen many, many things. Notice that it's in this century a huge spiritual demise of the West, because in the same period of time we have not seen the spiritual demise of the rest of the world. We have seen the gospelization, to coin a phrase, of the rest of the world. It's in the same period of time that we see China go from a spare 1 million Christians, which is all they had when Mao took over and began to oppress the church and kill the leaders and boot out the missions. Within 30 years, there were 50 to 80 million Christians. Today, 170 to 250 million Christians. We see all of sub-Saharan Africa, majority Christian. You've got nations that are 60, 70, 80%, I think Uganda, 88% Christian. You've got Indonesia, a huge Christian population now, probably 50 million Christians in Indonesia out of the 250. India, burgeoning rates of conversion and baptism. Pakistan, we hear reports of tens of thousands of people turning to Christ in a night. We hear of 1,000 Muslims becoming Christians in Egypt every week. It's all over the world. All of South America in your lifetime turned from darkness and superstition to huge numbers of Pentecostals. So you see, in your lifetime, every part of the world that was not of the West has had these burgeoning, growing, wonderful Christian movements, the church spreading everywhere. The overall effect is that the church has grown hugely. It's the largest single entity the kingdom of God is, or the body of Christ is, in the entire world today. But in the same period of time, the West has declined. There's been a spiritual demise. You've seen a rise of materialism, secularism, humanism, atheism, all kinds of godlessness. And the church ended up, even by the time I was a teenager, being looked upon as a place for women and kids, being effeminate, having no power, not being relevant, being despised. And yet that was within just a bare generation or a bit more of the church having been highly respected, having real honor in society, having a real voice of authority that spoke to governments. And it was the Bible that was informing the direction and the decision of the law of the land and of the function of all the courts. British common law, the greatest, legal establishment in the world over hundreds of years. It was the Bible that kept informing it, kept improving. It's been handed down to us. The reason we have so many liberties and such a low level of corruption and such a high level of health care and all the rest of it was because of the gospel. And I can put books in your hand that will show you the history of that through the history of the gospel in this last 2,000 years. So the good stuff you have, the freedoms they have, the fact that you have weekends, the fact that you've got Saturday off, Sunday off, you can rest before you've got to go back to work. You're not driven long hours as slaves and paid a pittance. All of these were direct outcomes from the gospel, and yet in your lifetime you've seen the spiritual demise of the West and the gospel being hardened against and the church being resisted, and this can't be a good thing. What's going to happen to these freedoms? What's going to happen to this high level? And where did it come from? What triggered the demise? And I was going to answer that question today with some detail, but don't have the time to. But I'm going to show you some conclusions, because something has caused the demise of the West. These things don't just happen in a vacuum. It's not that, the church suddenly gives up for no good reason. But the church basically rolled over and stuck its feet in the air and played dead. And there's a reason. It's because a very large percentage, not necessarily a majority, but a large minority of Christians changed what they believed. They changed their doctrine from what had been believed for the first 1800 plus years of Christianity, that is well into the 1800s, and the second half of the 1800s, new ideas were spawned, new doctrines that had never been taught before in the church, had no history of being taught in the church. You can read through all the old dusty books and you will fail to find a trace of it. But it started to rise, and then around the turn of the century, that is around 1900, a book was published which resulted in these doctrines becoming popular and getting a grip in America, so that this a large minority of the church gradually took to it and were brainwashed in it and believed it emphatically. And tens of thousands of pastors were trained in Bible colleges where that was the book being used and came out thinking this way. And the trouble is that the last century, the 20th century, was the 100 years in which most of the Christian money and most of the Christian missionary effort, well, more and more of it, and certainly most of the Christian books and nearly all the Christian television, all came out of America. So huge percentages of it were controlled by this, because it was many of the very active evangelicals and the majority of the Pentecostals that bought this bag of tricks and promoted it, and it became popular Christianity, and it produced these popular books, but with these alarmist doctrines that people thought was the Bible. What is that? What is that thing? Notice that the staggering decline of moral values in the West is obvious. The spiritual decline in the West is obvious, and it has gone in tandem, parallel, with the influence of that doctrine, because it changed the way Christians thought. Previously, Christians were of the belief that the gospel would triumph in the world, that the gospel was for all nations, that eventually all men would bow the knee to it, that the gospel would more and more civilize the world, that there would come a time of universal peace and prosperity that touched all nations, so that all nations would enjoy the fruits of the gospel that the West had been experiencing more and more themselves. That was the common belief right through almost all of Christianity. But the view that sprang up was a pessimistic view. It was a view that said the church was God's second thought, and that when Jesus came, he offered an earthly kingdom. He offered an earthly kingdom to the Jews in which they would rule the world, but they rejected it. And so as plan B, he decided to start the church instead and went to the cross. They claim it wasn't his plan to go to the cross. All this was plan B. No cross. What about the sin of man? But all this is ignorant of the scriptures. You pull out a verse here and a verse there and pull up a theory. But if you weren't given this theory just with a few buzz scriptures and told to read it this way, you would never have come up with those thoughts just by reading the Bible. And that wasn't all they said. Well, now the church has got this glorious gospel, a spiritual gospel, and people are being called into rest and into service with Jesus Christ, and one day the church will be raptured out of here. But the basic doctrine of these people says the church, now listen to it, the church will never succeed with the gospel. That's the doctrine they promoted. They said the church will ultimately fail, that it, toward the end there'll be a huge apostasy in the church and most will leave, and the church will be just this holy remnant and be raptured out of here. Oh, and then the Antichrist will come, and then the great tribulation, but eventually Jesus will come, and then he'll set up the earthly kingdom for the Jews and they will rule the world. And so they took all these precious gospel promises that were being fulfilled in history through the gospel and through the church, they took all these, what we call the kingdom promises, the kingdom prophecies, and took it out of the church and said, it doesn't belong to you. Church is only an afterthought. In fact, they said, there's not one word in the Old Testament about the church. It was never foreseen. And they say there's not a single prophecy in the whole Bible to be fulfilled in the church era. But after church is raptured, oh, that's when the prophecy will start to be fulfilled. And they took away from the church all its precious promises, all the stuff that was given to the church, its goals, its purpose. Well, what do you think is going to happen then? What do you think is going to happen to hundreds of thousands of ordinary, mum and dad and kid Christians all across the world have been believing for missions and giving to missions and praying for the gospel to do well in the jungles and all of that. What are they now going to do with a doctrine that says, oh, any day now the Antichrist will rise and we're going to be raptured out of here. Don't worry, the gospel's failing anyway and God's coming to rescue us. Where's the faith going to go? Can you tell me? What are they now going to believe? What are ordinary people going to believe if they believe that trash? They're going to stop praying prayers, believing for nations to succumb to the gospel because they've been told it won't happen, don't expect it. And this is why we've seen this cultural decline. This is why we've seen this huge washing into society of terrible immorality. It's because certain theologians who weren't even B-class, they were C-class, spread doctrines that were totally trash, do not fit the Bible properly, were the opposite of what Christians had always believed, and all that's been in this same era. So you end up with a Western church that has been emasculated. Do you know what that means? Enough said. Some of the guts was cut out of the church by new beliefs, different beliefs, leaving a church powerless and without faith. And the church became more materialistic, more self-centered. Dear God, help us. Not only that, have you noticed in the same period in the West, this rising of rates of disease, the like of which we didn't have before, obesity, cancer, heart disease, all these rates going up and up and up. Now, admittedly, we've got medicine and doctors and hospitals, but what accounts for all of that? Yes, you can say modern food processing, and all that, sure it does, but see, not enough gospel light is being applied. In other words, we've got the wealth, we've got the means, but we're struggling with ever more staggering issues, and that is the result of denying the gospel. So anyway, this was kind of the background to which I was going to say some things. Listen to this. The wealth of nations, education standards, health outcomes, stability of family life, soundness of government, and so on, are all directed either upwards or downwards spiritually. In the long term, these are determined by the spirituality of Christian people and by Christian doctrine within a nation. The reason why in your lifetime you are seeing China rise with wealth and power, you're seeing Indonesia rise with wealth and power, you're seeing India rise with wealth and power. Why is it these three nations? Why India and not Pakistan, for example? It's because these are the nations in which the gospel has spread and taken a grip, and there's more believers and there's more prayer, and God is determined to bless his people. So even when you get just 10% of a population, but we previously had one, but now they're walking with God and they're believing and others are getting saved, the fortunes of that nation will rise and God will give them a place in the world and they'll start to overcome problems and gain political influence and every other thing. And so we see the rise of these nations, we see the decline of the West. It's because they're rising in the gospel and we've been declining in the gospel, and I would lay the blame largely, if not almost completely, at the door of a doctrine called dispensationalism, which taught all this nonsense, and I regard it as heresy. The more I learn about the beliefs of that doctrinal system, the more it is not just an error, it is a heresy, a wicked great evil. Just to confirm, put Proverbs 14:34 up for me, Alex. This is just a simple text, probably don't even need it on the board. This is the one that says, righteousness exalts a nation, but sin condemns any people. You'd be more familiar with the old one that says, but sin is a reproach to any people. And then Psalm 33:12 says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he had chosen for his own inheritance. And it goes on in that psalm to say, verses 13-15, from heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, he considers everything they do. Do you see what this is saying to us? That with respect to every nation in the world, God is watching the hearts and considering what they all do. He is watching over nations. And it says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and it's righteousness that exalts a nation. Anyway, you probably didn't need me to prove that, but there it is. Same psalm goes on to say, no king saved by the size of his army. What saves nations then? The hand of God. It says, but the eyes of the Lord on those who fear him, the nation that fears God. God's eye is on it. To deliver them from death, it says, and keep them alive in famine. So I believe the spiritual and cultural decline of the West in the last century can be largely attributed, perhaps solely, to the rise of this popular doctrine. Now listen. I'm repeating myself, but this is a doctrine which had a novel introduction in the 19th century, novel meaning new, it was never there before. It was never previously taught in the church by any of 1800 years of apostles, fathers, theologians, scholars, teachers, authors, and it's quite contradictory to everything the Bible says, a proper understanding of the scriptures. It's a doctrine which, in using a few scriptures to make bizarre claims, totally and appallingly ignores many other profound and defining passages of scripture. It develops ideas in ignorance of and without reference to the historical context and without reference to the cultural meaning of terms used. Now it seems to disregard the facts of history. And yet the facts of history confirm the classic positions of the doctrines of our fathers. Further, this is very telling. It's a doctrine which holds the same views that the Pharisees and the apostate Jews did in the day they killed Jesus for Jesus having opposite views. This is very serious. The Jews of Jesus' day were totally expecting a nationalization of Jewish power, a restoration of the throne of David as an earthly event, and the rule of Jews over all nations. They were expecting this promised kingdom of God to be a materialistic and political affair, and it wasn't. And Jesus said to them, my kingdom is not of this world. He was here to die, to set up an alternative kingdom altogether, a spiritual kingdom, not a political kingdom. But the people who killed him were those who believed that the Jews had the right to believe the world, and they were expecting a Messiah who would set up a political kingdom. And the weird thing is that this dispensational doctrine has gone back to believing that Jesus will come as a Messiah and set up a political kingdom, and none of this is intended by the kingdom prophecies. Jesus began to fulfill those kingdom prophecies when he said, "My kingdom is not of this world," and said, had many, many other things to say about the kingdom, and I was going to show you what he actually did have to say about the kingdom. But it's such a huge study, that will have to be a study all on its own sometime, where we learn. I also think Christians are confused about the kingdom. We will have to learn what is the kingdom of God. And we'll come to that. And so not only that, but the Jews of Paul's day hated Paul, hounded him to his death. They vowed to kill him and tried to kill him, but meanwhile he's persecuted all over the world, as were many early Christians, precisely because they held Christ's doctrines of the kingdom as against the Jewish doctrines of the kingdom. And this went on for 40 years until the wrath of God was finally poured out and destroyed Jerusalem and destroyed the Levitical priesthood and destroyed the temple and the sacrifices forever, because by this time the church had been established all over the world. And we thank God for it. But those pernicious doctrines became widely accepted in North America, and this last 100 years have had a huge effect. What made it popular was a man called Schofield adopted this doctrine that others before him had been promoting for 50 to 70 years, but, you know, it hadn't gone far. But he took up on that, and he published what's called the Schofield Bible, in which his commentary, his text, is alongside the Bible text, and he will tell you what all these Bible passages mean, and he puts his interpretation on the Bible, so that this was the first time a Bible had ever been published with commentary in it. And at the front of the Schofield Bible, it promises the readers that he traces every major doctrine of the faith and connects every single scripture of the Bible that has anything to do with that doctrine all through the Bible, but he doesn't. The New Testament has 139 verses that refer to the kingdom, and he totally ignores 119 of them, and those 119 totally disagree with the kingdom theories of dispensationalism. But his Bible says, you know, they've traced all the major themes. Not so. I don't have time to share the detail on that. But this heresy is such an aberration from Christian thought that it required its own Bible, because God's Bible wouldn't do it for them effectively until they got their own Bible and people could work with a Schofield Bible where it was telling you what to believe about these things. The thing never, never took off and never gripped the public imagination. And so we have a heresy with its own Bible. Today I was going to outline just four of those heresies, show you what dispensationalism said, show you what the Bible says, but we don't have time, and we'll have to do it another day. But I was going to tell you what dispensationalists say in defining a dispensation, and I was going to show you what the Bible says in defining a dispensation, how the Bible uses the word. I was going to comment on the kingdom of God, what they say, what the Bible says, but the subject is so huge, I thought, no, we better leave that for another day, except to say this summary. In the Bible, the gospel of the kingdom and the gospel of salvation are the same thing, and you can find verses that tell you it's the same thing, but the dispensationalists will tell you it's two different gospels. In the Bible, the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God are the same thing, and you can find verses, passages make that very clear. But the dispensationalists will tell you that's two different kingdoms. The kingdom in the Bible is a spiritual kingdom, but they're promoting and looking forward to a material kingdom. They're saying that the church with the gospel will not succeed, but in fact in the world, the kingdom is growing and expanding across all nations, and doing it in this gospel era just as promised. The third error I was going to look at with you today, but now we can't, was this. One of the glaring errors of dispensationalism was their failure, a huge failure, to accept that the many things that are named with great reverence in the Old Testament scriptures as being especially significant, I'm talking about such things as Jerusalem, the temple, the priesthood, Mount Zion, and the kingdom, and Israel as a nation, and Israel as God's chosen people, these are things named in the Old Testament and treated as being especially significant and with reverence, that these are in fact natural things or materialistic, material things used temporarily as shadows and types of spiritual realities. So what the Old Testament has to say about the importance of Jerusalem was a shadow or a type pointing to the importance of a real Jerusalem. What it had to say about the significance of a temple was pointing to a spiritual temple that would come. So they were temporary, but they were shadows. They were types. And dispensationalism doesn't wear any of this, but holds onto the material and wants to reproduce it in the very era in which we're meant to be appreciating the spiritual realities. And those spiritual realities came through the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that all those terms are rich, rich terms relative to these spiritual realities. And they belong to us. They belong to us properly. They belong to us finally and eternally as the spiritual realities of the new covenant. And when I say they belong to us, they belong to what the Bible calls, the New Testament calls, the Israel of God. But the Israel of God, according to Paul in Galatians, are those believers in our Lord Jesus Christ who do not put confidence in the flesh but trust the cross alone, whether Jew or Gentile. These are the Israel of God, according to the biblical definition. And if you go back to the day when these words were written, these things were fulfilled by Jesus as son of David, son of Abraham, because of the promises made to Abraham. He came, gave his blood for the new covenant. All the apostles were Jews. All the first believers were Jews. Many of the Pharisees became Christians. Many of the priests became Christians. So quite a swathe of Jewish people became Christians, and they did that so all over the world. And so the initial church was thoroughly Christian. Its authors of the scripture were Jews who had become Christians, and this was Israel. This was the true Israel, that out of the natural Israel, out of the Israel that was a shadow and a type, came the true Israel, which was those Jews who believed in Jesus and who accepted the new covenant, that he'd came and he'd made this new covenant with Israel and with Judah. And then they discovered, oh, it wasn't only for us, but for the whole world. And any Gentile who comes in is one with us, the true Jews. Remember, these were Jews who believed in Jesus. The church was initially Jewish in Israel, still worshiping at the temple, still going to synagogues. We are the true Jews. Paul realized it. He's not a Jew, Paul wrote, who was one outwardly, but one who was one inwardly. And he was writing that to Gentiles as well as Jews. And so the true Israel was not all the population of everyone who'd been born genetically from Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, but it was those, first in that line, who all recognized their Messiah and stepped into the realities of the new covenant. This was the body of Christ. But in their minds, see, they were still Jewish, no Gentiles in yet. In their minds, this is the true Israel. Oh, we who were Israel all along have now really become Israel now that we're in Christ. Oh, and then they discovered that every door is open to the Gentiles. All the nations are supposed to join us. You know, here we are, the true Israel. Oh, all you Gentiles, you can join us. You can be Israel too. And that's where we are today. And for a while, they were just called followers of the way. It was like a Jewish sect. And then eventually somebody called them Christians. It was in Antioch, the Bible says, they were first called Christians. So these changes are taking place. And that's who we are today. This is the true Israel of God, whether you're Gentile or whether you're Jew. But of course, with time, so many Gentiles come in, the million. It's exactly what Jesus said. They'll come from the east, they'll come from the west, and sit down in the kingdom of God with Abraham, Isaac, and with Jacob. But some of you who think you're sons of Abraham, you're going to be cast out, he said to them. And some of them were. And so get your head around the fact, what is the true Israel? It still has descended very much from the Old Covenant, the Old Testament. It's descended very much from the patriarchs and the prophets and the scrolls, down through Christ and the apostles. This is still it. And we're in it, praise God. And I was going to show you the New Testament definitions, as clear as could be, of what is a Jew, what is Israel, what is Jerusalem, what is the seed of Abraham, what is Zion, and what are the 12 tribes. I'll show you the 12 tribes. Put up for me James 1:1 and then James 2:1. This is the kind of thing you find in the New Testament. It is as clear as day. Here's James 1:1. James. Now, James, by the way, was the leader of the Jerusalem church. And unless there were foreigners living in Jerusalem, they're all Jews. And he had 100,000. But James writes a letter, not just to the Christians there, Christians everywhere. And this is how he addresses them. A servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. He starts off, says it's all of Jesus. But then he says, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, greetings. Now, okay, he said to the 12 tribes. So is he writing this out just to Jews all over the world? To all the Jews scattered? No. One chapter later, he addresses them again. Take a look. My brothers and sisters. Well, of course, unfortunately, this is the NIV that's kind of gone non-sexist and all-inclusive, and so it's not as clear as in all the other translations. But look, my brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ must not show favoritism. Every other translation will say, brothers. As believers in our, he is writing, when he says the 12 tribes, he is writing only to Christian believers. The New Testament is very clear. All those Old Testament concepts, the material version of them, were shadows. They were types, and now we have a spiritual reality. It's phenomenal. And that's the least impressive. The others are even more impressive. But we leave that. I wanted to get onto the law, but time's long gone, and I'm going to have to quit. I was going to show you the narrow and disparaging view of the law that dispensationalists have, and compare that with what the Bible itself has to say about the law, what Moses had to say, what David had to say, what the psalmists had to say, what Solomon had to say, what the prophets had to say, what the Lord Jesus had to say, what Paul had to say about the law. How good it was, how purposeful, how much it transformed lives. Moses said that with regard to Sinai, God had showed his love to them by coming down and keeping the covenant he'd made with Abraham by giving them the law at Sinai. And the law was meant to do all these wonderful things. And the psalmist is saying, your law, show me your law that I may walk in it. There's all this discussion in the Bible about what the law, the transformation of lives through the word of God. And Moses said to them, he said, all the nations in the world will wonder and will marvel at the law that you have, that no other nation in all the law has such light, has such understanding. Now, it was a huge progress in its day, and the law of Moses was put in place to prepare for the gospel. It's not contrary to the gospel. It doesn't fight the gospel. It's put in place to prepare the way for the gospel. And the gospel is a fulfillment and a completion of what was begun with the law. And we must in the end have a proper understanding that yes, we're not under the works of the law, because under the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. We've got to understand how this all works, but it has a very important place. And the truth is, there's as much law in the gospel and in Christian life, much call to understand the law and walk in the ways of God now, as there ever was. And there was as much grace offered to men and women and believers in the Old Testament as there is now. All those greats were saved by grace. We must understand how to harmonize these things and not disparage them. So, dear friends, I've just given you a little summary here. And I need to finish here somewhere. Take this, for example. In Jeremiah 31, we find these two statements. Because we're comparing law and gospel, right? I'm saying the law prepares for the gospel completes what the law began. It harmonizes. Here's what Jeremiah said. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. This is the covenant I'll make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I'll put my law in their minds. Listen. Listen carefully. That is a phrase that describes the gospel. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. This is, in other words, we don't any longer have the law as Ten Commandments written on stone. We have the life of God, the principles of God, the truth of God, everything God has ever said written into our heart. We have the Holy Spirit, have a totally different way of grasping it. Ezekiel said, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. Who did he say this to? Israel. I will remove from you your heart of stone, give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit in you and move you, and move you. Now listen to this. He's talking about the gospel. I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. In other words, the Holy Spirit in us would achieve what stony hearts under the law didn't achieve. That's what the gospel does. You know, there's not one thing in the Ten Commandments or in any moral law of the Old Testament that is wiped away by the gospel and not renewed in the teaching. Go to the Sermon on the Mount. Go to Paul's epistles. No, we are meant to walk in the light of the law of God, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. Well, anyway, that's about all we have time for. And those four errors of dispensationalism, they're not even the main ones that have caused the cultural decline. But I know for myself, I have to make this clear to you because I have to make the gospel clear to you. I have to make the kingdom of God clear to you. I've got to make the word of God and its power clear to you, because unless you believe right, you're going to muddle along in life. And neither do we want to re-promote errors and mixture. We want a very clear view of what the Lord has to say to this world and carry it in our hearts and pray out of it. If we pray out of the truth, we're going to get phenomenal answers in the nations. We get our eyes off all the sensationalist rubbish, get our eyes on what God has promised, and in our prayers and our faith, let's go for it, because there are nations to be brought into submission to our Lord Jesus Christ. We must have the faith of God in us. I just close on this note. Every wrong belief that someone holds, whether they know it or not or like it or not, produces unintended consequences that are negative. That doesn't matter what it is. Hayes and I here have been married 44 years as of a couple of weeks ago, and we are both confident of each other. She totally trusts me. I totally trust her. There is not a shadow of doubt or fear that impinges upon that trust. I don't fear or doubt her motives or anything she does or anything she might do when I'm not around or I'm away, and vice versa with her. And because I know her well, she knows me, and because of that confidence, we can be relaxed in life, restful, only think about doing good for each other, only think about trusting each other. But what if one of us, or both of us along the way, had have developed falsely, a false belief, not a true one, a false belief that said, oh, I can't trust her, or I can't trust him. And deep down, we thought that. I'm a bit suspicious. What are they doing and I'm not there? You know, and where are they going? Oh, and who are they talking to on the phone? And, you know, it's just a little belief, right? It's only a little, oh, what if? Just a little doubt, just a little fear. But you know what that leads to? All kinds of uncertainty. You know, you care for what you say, you're always looking, and it produces, come on, little beliefs produce strange outcomes that affect the quality of life, will drag down relationships. And then you end up with arguments, you end up saying things you should never say. I mean, just worse and worse comes from it, right? And that can come from a false belief. And when Christians have bad doctrine, it affects their worldview, it changes what they expect. As soon as you change the expectations of the heart, guess what? Opens the spirit realm to all kinds of evils and lies to come in. It changes the way they're going to pray. It's changed the way they give money, changed the way they spend the time, and it changes all the thinking, attitudes, influence, and worldview that they put into little Johnny and Mary in their growing up, even if they're not conscious, they're saying it. Kids grow up, jaundiced worldview. This is why we must have good doctrine. It's why we must know what the Bible says and what it doesn't say, and that's why all the roots of this wretched heresy need to be cleaned out of our lives. We need to know when we hear things, that's false, that's error, or this is true. We need to know what we stand on. And so, bit by bit, over the course of the year, a bit here and a bit there, I'll just make it clearer to you what you know, doctrines we can trust, what we can't trust. But normally, I will show you from the scriptures what it actually says. And we don't take ever one scripture for it, do we? You might think this is my weakness because it takes a little bit too long or there's a little bit too much detail. Listen, every truth is established in the mouth of two or three witnesses. I will not put up one scripture that say, here's the truth. Sometimes you're in a hurry, but generally speaking, I will give you a look at three and four. Here's the Bible pattern. Here's what it means, because you must know it's the truth. And I'm happy if someone finds something there that seems to be different. You come sit down and talk about it. We all reappraise our thinking. I've done this, had to do it all the way along my life. There's certain things you think are right. As you go along, you realize, oh, no, we've got to adjust this. Because in the end, we want to end up with really, really accurate truth. So one of our goals, you know, in the next little while will be to give you a proper and a broad understanding of what the Bible does say about the kingdom of God. What kind of kingdom is it? And Jesus preached the kingdom from the beginning of his ministry to the end of the kingdom, end of his ministry. He told the disciples to go out and preach it while he was alive. He told the disciples to preach the kingdom after he had gone. And when he taught the parable of the sower, he said the word, the seed being sown, was the word of the kingdom. Well, that kingdom is the gospel. It's the gospel kingdom going out into the hearts of men, making us citizens of heaven. Yes, the kingdom of God is the gospel nation. It's the church. It's the body of Christ. It's the Israel of God as the nation of the spiritual nation of God's people, scattered all through the world. Thank you for listening, and thank you for the extra bit of time you gave me. You now deserve your coffee. Oh, so pray with me. I'm going to thank the Lord that we've got a gospel worthy of believing. It's a good gospel. The gospel of our salvation. How wonderful is that? Oh, I thank God our names are written in heaven. We are not going to fear the times we live in. And whenever somebody comes along with a theory that sounds, you know, a bit different, a bit alarming, a bit wild, or, oh, this is going to happen, that's going to happen, just take it with a grain of salt. This has been going on for 2,000 years. Remember Jesus said, they'll say, oh, look, here's the Christ, there's the Christ. Oh, he's out in the desert. Don't believe, he says. He warned you already. False prophets. These are blind leaders of the blind. We're not going to be blind. We have eyes opened by the Holy Scriptures. So I think along the way I have to show you what is the real kingdom. I can tell you now it is not an earthly kingdom that's coming. It's not a kingdom of the Jews that's coming. There will not be a temple rebuilt and a Levitical priesthood. The Bible already has ruled it all out. We are building, though, the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to the Bible, 2,000 years ago said he's already taken his power and begun to reign. That was 2,000 years ago. And the same book says he's the ruler of the kings of the earth. He raises up one king, he puts down another. He's bit by bit taking all the nations of this world to a place where gospel glory will be there, gospel providence, gospel grace and power and prosperity and peace. That's what we're looking for. Don't look at the news and see all this rubbish going on. No, we're going to be opposing this more and more in our prayers and believing God ultimately for far better outcomes in Australia. So pray with me. Father, I thank you. Thank you for the gospel. Thank you for the gospel of the kingdom. Thank you for the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of Christ our Savior, the kingdom of his dear Son. And thank you. You gave it all these many and varied names because it is all of these things and more. The kingdom that's in our hearts. The kingdom, as Jesus said, being within you or in your midst. And I thank you, Lord, you said it was the gospel that transferred us from the dominion of Satan and of darkness into the kingdom of your dear Son. We stand in that kingdom today. Thank you, Lord, this growing kingdom, just as you said to Daniel the prophet, would grow and grow until it fills the whole world and grind every other kingdom to dust. That's what you said, O God. And Lord, teach us more of what you said and of what you meant so that we do not have to be so foolishly sidelined by the doctrines of men, doctrines of demons. And yet, Lord, our world, these Western nations have been so harmed. I pray today for the healing of these lands. I ask you, Lord, that you'd heal Australia and heal all these other lands and turn these nations back from the darkness that has encroached upon lands that had previously had such great inheritance. I'd ask you, Lord, restore the confidence of your people. Restore the strength of your arm in these nations. And lift up the truth again. And I thank you, Lord, that for 20 and 30 years, more and more people, larger numbers of pastors all the time, are turning away from the horrors of dispensationalism and finding the truth again. I thank you, Lord, it's happening all over the world. I thank you, Lord, wherever I've gone and preached this, people have breathed such a sigh of relief, and so many pastors have said to me that what I'm saying is the truth, and that's what they've really believed all along. Thank God for them. Lord, strengthen now your people all over this world that we might have eyes again for the glory of Christ. That glory be upon the nations, just as your word said, O Lord. The whole earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. I thank you, Lord, your word still says, in his days shall the righteous prosper. And so, Lord, I call upon your name again. Raise up the righteous in Australia and cause the righteous to prosper. Ultimately, Lord, this nation to prosper. I pray, make this nation righteous again and turn it back from evil. And even now, Lord, I pray for government in this land, and I ask that you take every wicked person out of the parliaments, every one of them. I ask today you'd cut the ground from under them. And this day, in the presence of a holy God, with the Holy Spirit present, with the Lord Jesus present, I speak concerning every parliamentarian in this land, federal parliaments, state parliaments, who denies the truth and who stands for immorality and would seek to bring in such evil laws. And this day, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I hand them over to you, O Lord. I hand them over to you. Either change them or get rid of them. Lord, any of them that are brands to be snatched from the burning, snatch them out. Any branches from the burning, snatch them. If you can save them, save. And any others, O Lord, ask, pull the rug out from under them. I hand them over to you for judgment. And I ask, O Lord, that you would clean out the parliaments of this land and raise up people who fear God and whose desire is for the well-being of society and the protection of our children. I ask you, Lord, you'd destroy the power of every wicked lobby and grant us the restoration and the maintenance of the image of God in society. Lord, protect the image of God, I pray, in holy matrimony. Give yourself a witness, O Lord. All these other Western nations succumbed and bowed their knee to evil influences. But I ask you, Lord, that Australia will stand firm. Give yourself a witness amongst these nations of the truth. Let there not be a united voice against the truth. Let it not be, O Lord, that even the last of those Western nations would succumb on this point so that there is a unified voice that's lying to the rest of the world. Father, I cry out, spare this nation and turn back this evil. and let wrath be visited upon those individuals who are driving this agenda for the destruction of the social fabric of the nation. Let the wrath of God be visited upon them. I ask the Lord, you'd clean house today. Hear my cry. Let the hand of God be upon it in righteous judgments. Lord, in wrath, remember mercy. I place it in your hands in Jesus' name. And now I pray, put into the heart of all those who know you, the Spirit of truth speaking such truths as will witness to every spirit. May the Holy Spirit be the Spirit of truth in this land. I ask that the Holy Spirit would be the Spirit of truth in the hearing of all the Christians. I ask, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would be the Spirit of truth in the hearing of the population of Australia, so that no matter what we read in the media, in the hearts of men and women everywhere, there'll be a knowledge. This is rubbish. Lord, I pray the Holy Spirit be the Spirit of truth in our cities and towns. Be the Spirit of truth in the hearing of all the people of Rockhampton and of this nation. Lord, I place it in your hands today. I seek you. I seek you for godly outcomes and call upon the honor of your name. Thank you, Lord, God who answers prayer. I call upon your name. And we put our trust in God to answer prayer. And now, Lord, I pray concerning these families here, these men and women here, these believers, the young and the old, would you be with them and help them, every one of these, live lives to the glory of God, fill their homes with good things, that is, fill their homes with angels and with revelation and understanding and a knowledge of the truth and with confidence in life and an inner knowledge that they have your blessing and have permission to succeed. I ask you, Lord, you bless every home, bless every marriage, bless the children, watch over them all and provide for them. And Father, I pray especially today, would you all join me in prayer for Shirley Fisher, who has a very serious health issue right now. And Shirley's been a great servant of all, great servant of the church, in practical things and spiritual things, tireless, such a good heart. We're going to ask the Lord to remember Shirley. And Father, I ask that you'd lay your hand upon Shirley right now and heal her. I ask the Lord that you'd remove the blood disorder and put her blood in order, put all the organs of her body in order. I ask the Lord that you would restore Shirley to health, restore Shirley to us. Lord, protect her. I place over Shirley the protection of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord.